Thank you, Pastor. Magandang umaga po sa inyo, lahat. Pag-rati po mga sa ating presidente, Rodrigo Duterte. Good morning. It is so good to be back and to share to you what the Lord is doing in the island. You're part of what the Lord is doing in the island. I want to show you one of the testimony of our first graduate in our School of Mission. Is Pastor Von Pastas. In order for you to graduate in our School of Mission there, you have to finish the curriculum. You have to baptize 10 believers, new believers, so that we will be sure that you know how to evangelize. And your 10 baptized believers must be able to baptize 20, so that we'll be sure that you know how to disciple people. So our first graduate will give his testimony, and I want to show this video.
It was about 14 years ago when God started to work in the small island of Coron, Palawan. So God called Pastor Dignadise with his family to start a work there. By faith, they left everything they had and followed the Lord in Coron, and they started with very humble beginnings. Coron is home to the Tacbanwa tribe, and different nationalities would actually come and migrate there as well. People from US, Europe, China, name it. After 11 years, through many ups and downs, God began to call more men and women of God to step up and follow the Lord in His call, and we were able to plant 3 more churches. In our 11th year, God called a man named Elmer Ladao to start a work in his hometown, the island of Dinapakan, which is 6 hours away from Coron. Now, this guy wasn't a graduate of Bible school, he wasn't a gifted speaker or a great musician, but all we knew was that in the morning he would wake up and he would pray as early as 3 a.m. And a few months later, he came back and he told us he had already baptized his mom, his dad, his family, and they were averaging about 30 to 40 people every Sunday. So the rest of the young people were shocked and amazed, and we wondered, God, when are you going to use us the way you're using Coach Elmer? A lot of us gave our lives to God, and he particularly called me to start a new church in Barangay 3, and we would wake up at 5 in the morning to pray. So we started doing visitations and intentionally pray for people and be more involved in their lives. God also led us to start a police ministry and become really good friends with them, and we ministered to those who were in jail. I believe that the body of Christ just really wanted to show the love of Jesus, that they started the hospital ministry and lots of campus ministries. So after 2 years of seeing God's powerful work, the body of Christ prayed and decided to send out a team of 5 to the next barangay to plant a new church. Though most of us did not really graduate in a formal Bible school, but we believe we have the Holy Spirit, the Word of God, and the people of God. Today, as of July 2016, God has blessed Jesus' young followers with 17 churches, all the way from Quezon City, from Coron and Salvacion, to Puerto Princesa, Dinapakan and Dekabayota. And just recently, a few weeks ago, God called Pastor Clay and Coach Orange to start a new work in Baguio, which is north of the Philippines. It has not always been easy. One of the most difficult times was when Yolanda, the world's strongest typhoon, devastated Coron, Palawan. Though we survived, we did experience a lot of loss. But we praise God because the church was mature enough to see it as a privilege and opportunity to share the love of God to those in need. JYF has such a big heart for the youth. In fact, we have about 800 kids who are enrolled in our children's ministry, and we make sure to disciple them at a very early age up to the time when they graduate from college. God has also blessed JYF with an AC school that has raised many of our leaders today. We praise God for the lives of our teachers. We also give the youth training in music and in sports and in however means, just as long as we could reach them for the glory of Jesus Christ and disciple them. Year after year after year, God is increasing the work and the number of believers in Coron, Palawan, and all over the Philippines. So because of the growing work of the Lord, the body of Christ prayed, took a step of faith, planted the seeds of faith for the bigger and better youth center of Coron, Palawan. We believe with all of our heart that God is going to use this place to bring many more souls to His kingdom. May the God of wonders continually use us and use you as we partner together for the sake of His kingdom until all the nations will bow down and worship Him. To God be the glory. Hey guys, so as you can see that maroon and green roof over there, yeah, that's where the church meets every Sunday. And it's just amazing to think that 3 years ago, we only had 3 churches here in Coron. But after 3 years, God is just so amazing in raising up men and women who followed His call. And today, we're humbled to say that we have already 11 outreaches all over Coron, Palawan. This is where the construction is going on. And here in my hands is the covenant form. Every member of JYF has pledged to give to God. And if you would like to help in any way, please let me know. Contact me through my Facebook or through Pastor Paul in that case. And on behalf of Jesus Young Followers Philippines, we would like to thank you for being such a big blessing to us. You rest assured that we're praying for you every single day. And we hope and pray that you will continue to partner with us for the sake of the gospel, for His kingdom, and for His glory, until all the nations will bow down before Him. Thank you so much. May God bless all of you.
Fire, fire, fire!
On behalf of our people from the island, we just want to thank you for praying for us. You are part of what the Lord is doing in Coron. Please tell your neighbor you are part of it. Thank you very, very much. The Lord has entrusted to us almost more than 800 kids right now. So we started praying to build a covered court for them so that they can have an activity there, sports, music, arts. And we have started already. We finished the earth moving, we finished the foundation and the pedestal for the steel post. We are now on the flooring. So as we go in United States right now, we are challenging our prayer partners who pray for us to invest for a bag of cement. A bag of cement will cost you $5, $5.50. So if you want to be part of it, you can give a bag of cement. Amen?
Yes.
But if you will give a bag of cement, when you go to Coron and it is worship time, you don't move, right? Because you have only given a bag of cement. If you worship and you move, you must give 2 bags of cement. Okay? Is that fair?
Yeah.
So continue to pray with us. We are praying that the Lord will just build it and be ready for our 14th year anniversary.
I start the
$5. Oh, there's a seal of faith for $5 for 1 bag of cement. Thank you very, very much. Mama, thank you very much. God bless you. And we are challenging everyone to be part of it. You know, every time we give this challenge, we are giving a chance for everyone to be part of what the Lord is doing, and you will be blessed by the Lord as you participate in His work in the island of Coron. We want to invite everyone in our 14th anniversary, the last week of January. If you are ready, please come and let us worship together in the island. I want to share to you, let us open our Bibles, let's get our Bibles. And I just want to share to you what the Lord is teaching me these days from the book of Luke. The Lord has been so good in teaching me some things in the book of Luke. And but before we open our Bibles, Luke chapter 9, verse 23 to 26. We'll be studying Luke 9, 23 to 26. But before we read the scripture, let me ask you an important question. Because this question, the answer to this question will lead you to a greater knowledge of who Jesus is. And your answer to this question will determine how you will listen to the Word of God this morning. Let me ask this question. Are you a committed follower of Jesus? Are you a committed follower of Jesus? In Jesus' time, there are followers of Jesus. There are casual followers of Jesus.
They just follow Jesus because of the food and because of the need. That's casual followers of Jesus. There are convinced followers of Jesus in their time. But there is a type of person who follows Jesus in their time. They call it the committed follower of Jesus. My question is, are you a committed follower of the Lord Jesus Christ? Notice I didn't ask you, are you a Christian? I asked you, are you a follower of Jesus? Because there are a lot of people who are claiming to be Christians today. But if you will look at their lives, they are not following Jesus of the Bible. Probably they are following the Jesus that they have made, but not the Jesus of the Bible. So are you a follower of Jesus? Because I have a news for you this morning. You don't get to heaven in eternity if you don't follow Jesus here on earth. Because the Bible says in John chapter 14, verse 6, Jesus doesn't say, I will show you the way. He doesn't say, I will point you to the way. Jesus said, I am the way. And Jesus said, invited his followers. He said, come, follow me. Are you a committed follower of Jesus? Let's open our Bibles in the book of Luke chapter 9. And I'm requesting everyone to please stand in reverence to God's word. Luke chapter 9, verses 23 to 26. And he was saying to them all, if anyone wishes to come after me, he must deny himself and take up his cross daily and follow me. For whoever wishes to save his life will lose it. But whoever loses his life for my sake, he is the one who will save it. For what is a man profited if he gains the whole world and loses or forfeits himself? For whoever is ashamed of me and my words, the Son of Man will be ashamed of him when he comes in his glory and the glory of the Father and of the holy angels. Let us pray. Our gracious God and Heavenly Father, this morning we acknowledge you that you are our holy God. You are holy Lord, and you require holiness to everyone who will study your holy word. So Lord, I pray this morning that you will cleanse us from all unrighteousness of man. Make us worthy to study your holy word. Lord, we acknowledge that we are nothing apart from you. Be merciful to us, O Heavenly Father. Open our minds, Lord. Open our hearts. Help me, Lord, to share your word with love today. This is my prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Please be seated. As a background of our text this morning, our text is after the feeding of 5,000. 5 loaves of bread, 2 fishes. Remember that? Okay, in chapter 9, verse 18, look at your Bible. We will be studying the Word of God, just open your Bibles. Chapter 9, verse 18 says there, and it happened while he was praying alone, the disciples were with him, and he questioned them, saying, who do people say I am? Jesus asked his disciples, who do people say I am? So, you look at verse 19 and 20, you can see there, the disciples answered Jesus, verse 19 and 20. They answered and said, John the Baptist, and others say Elijah, but others, one of the prophets of old has risen again. And he said to them, but who do you say that I am? And Peter answered and said, the Christ of God. The Christ of God. And then you can see in chapter 9, verse 23 to 26, Jesus' declaration of the marks of the follower of Jesus. The marks of a follower of Jesus. So if you want to be a follower of Jesus Christ today, I will not lead you into prayer and just give you some words to say to be a follower of Jesus. We will look at the scripture
and look at the marks of a true follower of Jesus Christ. But before we dive into our text this morning, let me ask you, who is Jesus to you? Who is Jesus to you? The same question that Jesus gave to his people, to his apostles. Who is Jesus to you? The answer to that question will determine how you will live your life today. The answer to that question, who is Jesus to you, will determine how you will live your life today. Let me give you a short tour of the later part of the life of Jesus, the last hours of Jesus here on earth. Let's look at Luke chapter 22, verse 39 to 46. Luke chapter 22, 39 to 46. We can see there that Jesus is in the Garden of Gethsemane. In verse 39, 22, look at your Bibles. 39 says, "And he came out and proceeded as was his custom to the Mount of Olives, and the disciples also followed him." This is Jesus in the Mount of Olives praying. And you can see in verse 40 and verse 46, Jesus warned his disciples to pray so that they will not enter into temptation. And you can see in verse 42, Jesus' prayer request. His prayer request is that Jesus, God, Lord, please, verse 42, let's read it. Saying, "Father, if you are willing, remove this cup from me, yet not my will, but yours be done." What is the cup there? What is the cup there? Scholars said the cup there is the divine wrath of the Heavenly Father. The divine wrath of the Heavenly Father. Someone said to me, "You know, Pastor, if God is loving, why are these things happening to us?" Yes, he said, "Pastor, God is wrathful, full of wrath in the Old Testament. But in New Testament, you can see him loving, not hating sin." Actually, that is not true. You want to see the wrath of God in the New Testament? You want to see the perfect wrath of God in sin in New Testament? You look at the cross and you will see the wrath of God in sin. Isaiah 53 said, "It pleases the Lord to crush his son." Can you imagine crushing your son? What will make you crush your son? But in Isaiah 53, it says, "It pleases the Heavenly Father to crush his son." Why? It is because of your sins and my sins. The Heavenly Father showed his wrath on the cross. He showed in the cross that he is holy God. He hates sin. He is the same yesterday, today, and forever. You want to see the perfect picture of God's love? You look at the cross and you will see the perfect love of God. The Bible says, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life." So when you look at the cross, it is where the wrath of God in sin and the love of God meets. That is the cross. And Jesus Christ knew at that time what he will suffer in the hands of the Heavenly Father because of your sin and my sin. That's why he is asking the Heavenly Father, "Heavenly Father, can you please take this cup from me?" But he said, "Not my will, but yours be done." That's the prayer of Jesus. And Jesus was in agony. He was praying very fervently, it says there. Why? Because he fully knew the wrath of God. Verse 45, look at 22, 45. Look at verse 47, sorry, 47. 47 says, "While he was still speaking," the Lord Jesus Christ was talking to his disciples, "Do not sleep, pray, that you would not enter into temptation. While he was still speaking, here comes verse 47, says, while he was still speaking, behold, the crowd came, and one called Judas, one of the 12, was preceding them, and he approached Jesus to kiss him. So at this point, in verse 47 to 4 to 53, we can see here how Judas betrayed Jesus at this point. Have you experienced being betrayed by a good friend, by your best friend, by your boyfriend, or by a girlfriend? What does it feel? Can you imagine Jesus? Judas is one of his disciples. Probably they said that he is the treasurer of the 12. And he lived with Jesus for 3 years. They live together, they eat together, they sleep together. And at this point of time, you can see Judas betraying Jesus with a kiss. What will you feel at that time? Next, you will see here in Luke chapter 22, verse 54 to 63, we can see that Peter, also one of the 12, denied Jesus 3 times. Wow! Can you imagine that with your first 12? You will have your D12 here, right, Pastor? You will have your D12, and you have your D12, and two of your D12 will betray you and will deny you. Come on. That will be heavy for a pastor. That is heavy for Jesus at this time. But that we can see here that Peter denied Jesus 3 times. And then in verse 20, in chapter 23, you can see there the people. You can see there the people shouting, crucify him, crucify him. Let us go back to the question in Luke chapter 9, verse 18 to 20. Who do you say I am? Who is Jesus to you? Are you a committed follower of Jesus of the Bible? Who is Jesus? He is there. He is so loving. He died for you. Actually, you and I are going to heaven because of your sin and because of my sin. God gave his son to die on the cross because he loves you and he loves me. Actually, it is impossible for a holy God to love a sinner like you and like me. Can you imagine the love of the heavenly Father? And he is that great. Let me ask you, will you betray Jesus with a kiss like Judas? Are you betraying our Jesus today with a kiss like Judas? Are you denying Jesus like Peter? You will say, Pastor, I will not deny Jesus. Let me ask you, are you willing to be in prison for Jesus? I believe time will come, even in your country, there will come a time that your faith will be tried. Are you willing to be in prison for Jesus? Don't answer me. Just answer for yourself. Next question is, are you willing to die for Jesus? Are you willing to die for your Jesus? Can you imagine sharing your faith to a Muslim? And he will say to you, I'm ready to die for what I believe. I can put explosive in my body and die for what I believe. Are you willing to die for Jesus? So let me ask you, are you willing to die for Jesus? Let's look at Luke chapter 20 to 33. This is very interesting because but he said to him, this is Peter saying to Jesus, Lord, with you, I'm ready to go both to prison and to death. The same promise that Peter gave to Jesus, right? But after that, he denied Jesus 3 times. You know, brothers and sisters in the Lord, many, many times we deny Jesus with the way we talk. And not only by the way we talk, but by the way we live our lives today. The way we live today. We deny Jesus by the way we live in our lives. Many times we live our lives satisfied with the things of this world. But there is room for repentance and grace. If you are denying Jesus the way you live today, with the love of Jesus, I say, repent. Ask God's forgiveness. When you live your life and you show that the things of this world will satisfy you, I think it is one way of denying Jesus the way you live. Are you living a life now that only Jesus satisfies? Or are you shouting with the crowd, crucify him, crucify him? You will say this morning, Pastor, I'm inside the church. I'm a worship leader. I preach in the church. I'm part of the worship team. I preach. Let me show you a strong reminder from the Word of God with all love. Matthew 7, 21 to 23. Matthew 7. Matthew 7. Matthew 7, 21 to 23. Not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven, but he who does the will of my Father who is in heaven will enter. Many will say on that day, this is the Lord Jesus speaking, Lord, Lord, did we not prophesy in your name? In your name cast out demons, and in your name perform many miracles, and then I will declare to them, I never knew you. Depart from me, you who practice lawlessness. That is a strong reminder from the Word of God. Let me ask you, have you experienced casting out demons? Has anyone experienced making miracles in this church? You turned water into wine. Or is anyone here in the church experience prophesying? No? These people prophesy. These people make miracles in Jesus' name. Actually, they know Jesus. When they say, Lord, Lord, they feel they really know Jesus. They really know the Lord. They perform miracles. They make prophecies. They cast out demons. But Jesus said to them, away from me. Away from me. I do not know you. You lawless people. The word lawless there is the word we get anomia. The anomia word in the original, it means you live as if I haven't given you a law to obey. The Word of God says, if you love me, obey my commandments. When you live, when you disobey the Lord, the Word of God, you live as lawless person. And time will come, this is a strong reminder, not only to you, but this is a strong reminder to me. How is my relationship with the Lord? Am I a committed follower of Jesus? Now, will you respond to Jesus' call for a personal relationship with him? We can see, let's look at our text, Luke chapter 9, our true text, 9. Luke 9, 23 to 26. We can see the marks of a committed follower of Jesus. Number one, a committed follower of Jesus responds to his call for a personal relationship with him. This means you have repented, turned from your sinful self nature, and trusted in Jesus as your Savior and as your Lord, and the Lord over your life in such a way that your life now belongs to him and you committed to following him. You are completely and daily dependent on him. I'm not asking you if you have a religion and if you are a Christian. I'm asking you now, do you have a personal relationship with Jesus that is true and personal? When I say Jesus, I'm talking about the Jesus of the Bible. Because many, many times inside the church, we have made a Jesus that likes what we like. His standards are the same with our standards. And we control him. We changed him so many times. We did not change our lives to his standards, but we changed this Jesus. I call him the neighbor of Jesus. His name is Jesse. So a lot of Christians today are not following the Jesus of the Bible, but they're just following the Jesse that they have made. Looks like Jesus, but not the real Jesus. And not the real Jesus will bring you to him. You know, a lot of people today, they say in Tagalog, they said, a lot of people inside the church are, they just Christian-Christianan. Sa atin, Tagalog, or Christian-Christianan. But always remember, the people who are Christian-Christianan will just go to langit-langitan. Okay? The people who are just Christian-Christianan will go to langit-langitan. Please have an interpreter there. So if you are a Christian-Christianan, you will go to? And that's not the langit. Okay? So now, second, a mark of a committed follower of the Lord Jesus Christ. Number two, a committed follower of Jesus denies himself. Let's look at our text. Let's go back to our text. I want us to focus on our text. And he was saying to them all, if anyone wishes to come after me, he must deny himself. This is what Apostle Paul is teaching in 1 Corinthians chapter 9. If you will look at chapter 9 of 1 Corinthians, 7 times Apostle Paul used this word to relinquish. You can see there the right in verse 4, verse 5, verse 6, twice in verse 12, 15, and 18. You can see there the word right. Apostle Paul is saying, I have all the right. I have my rights as a follower of the Lord Jesus Christ, as an apostle of the Lord Jesus Christ. I have all the rights. But he said, I relinquish my right for the sake of the gospel, for the sake of Christ, and for the sake of the gospel. Apostle Paul said, I relinquish my rights and obey Jesus. Abandon all for the sake of Christ. Brothers and sisters in the Lord, you have all the rights here in the United States. You have the rights for your life, friends, marriage, family, safety, security, health, happiness. You have the right to eat, drink, watch, wear, read, study, listen, and say whatever you want. Organize your schedule, spend your time, choose your career, make your money, take your vacation, and plan your retirement. In the end, you have the right to do what you want to do, go where you want to go, and live how do you want to live. But as committed followers of Jesus, the cross compels you to surrender your rights for the sake of the gospel and Jesus. Here in the world around you, with all of my love, I'm begging to you that you relinquish your rights here in the United States so that more people in the world will hear Jesus and stuff. There is a survey that says if the believers in the United States will just give their tithes and offering, there will be no poor people in the world. The Lord Jesus Christ said, go make disciples. He doesn't stop there. He said, go make disciples of all nations, of all people groups, of all languages. And you are part of God's agenda of reaching the world. That's why we thank you for praying for us. And a lot of you are helping us in the islands. We work together so that we can reach the goal of Jesus for us. That is to reach all people, and every nation will be worshipers one day. Every tongue, every nation will worship the true God that we worship today. That is what God wants us. For the sake of the gospel, let us relinquish our rights for our time. I beg of you, relinquish some of your rights in your time. Actually, one of our friends in LA said, I'm challenging him, you know, you have to make disciples because this is not a suggestion to you. This is a command. The Great Commission is not a suggestion for you, brothers and sisters. The Great Commission is a command for you, and not obeying it is a sin. He said, Pastor, I'm busy. But I heard you're playing golf. How much time do you spend playing golf? He said, 4 hours. Oh, come on. You have your time with your golf. You don't have time to make disciples. Brothers and sisters, with all my love, I do not know every one of you. But let me remind you from the Word of God that it is God's great commandment. It is a command from the Lord that you make disciples. Probably you're saying, Pastor, you're from the island. You know, you do not know what's on life here. We are busy. If that is your answer today, let me pray for you. I would say to the Lord, Lord, I'm praying that this brother or sister will have time for you. What will you say if you will go to heaven? You cannot bring us. If you will be dying and you will be asking me, Pastor, can you come with me so that we can face God? I will not go with you. Probably other pastor will not go with you too. But you will face one day, we know that, right? We will be facing our Creator. And He has commanded us, go and make disciples. Before going back to heaven, Jesus said, make disciples of all nations. And one day you will be in front of Jesus. One day you will be in front of God. And what will you say? Jesus, I disobeyed you. You put me in the United States. You don't know the schedule there. So just forgive me because you put me in San Francisco, it's busy there. So I live in disobedience. Oh, what do you think will happen? Actually, many people are saying also, friends saying, you know, we are in the United States. Our friend in Los Angeles said, you know, Pastor, people in the United States are not working, really not because they want food. They have a lot of food in the United States. People in the United States are working for extra, you know. For extra. Extra cigarette. To have a good life here. Good life, good retirement. This is what I believe. Just sharing this to you. I believe with all my heart, if God wants you to just have a good life, if God wants you to experience good life, the moment to receive Jesus as personal Lord and Savior, have a relationship with Jesus, the moment to receive Jesus, He brought you back to heaven right away. Right? So if you want a good life today, the best life for you, I'll stand here after the service and I'll pray for you. Father, this brother, this sister wants a good life. Take him. Take her now. If that's what you want in life, the best life is in the presence of the Heavenly Father. I believe that you are still alive today and you are here in San Francisco because God has a mission for you here. Amen?
Amen?
God has a mission for you here. Not in Africa, not in the islands of the Philippines. God brought you here in San Francisco because He has a purpose in your life. You have a mission in life to accomplish here in San Francisco. Amen?
Amen.
Can you tell your neighbor you have a mission to accomplish?
Amen.
You have a mission to accomplish. Amen? Amen? Your mission, and my mission is Jesus' mission. Jesus said, I have come to save and to seek that which was lost. His mission, Jesus' mission, is your mission. Tell your neighbor, your mission is Jesus' mission. Okay, that's good. Let me throw another question to you this morning. Do you love the Lord? Do you love the Lord? With all your heart, with all your soul. You know, I'm in the ministry for quite some time. And when I see people worshiping the Lord, you know, crying, I love you, Lord, and I lift my voice.
When I see people, you know, saying, I love you, Lord, saying, I love you, Lord, crying, I said, oh, she really loves the Lord. She really loves the Lord. And too many times, after seeing those people, knowing that they are living in sin, oh, I said, come on, he's lying. If you will ask me, how will you know, Pastor, that if I love the Lord or not? Let me bring you to the Word of God. Matthew chapter 6, verse 21. Matthew 6, 21. It says, this is a verse that will show us if you really love the Lord. The verse says, Jesus, this is in red letter, right? It says there, for where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. For where your treasure is, there will your heart be. You want to see if you really love the Lord? You look at your checkbooks. You will see that if you really love the Lord. If you spend a lot for yourself, you love yourself more than the Lord. Amen?
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 It's hard, right? But it's the Word of God anyway. It's not my word. So if you love the Lord, you see there, for where your treasure is, there will your heart be. Number three, mark of a committed follower of Jesus. A committed follower of Jesus takes up his cross daily. A husband came to me and said, Pastor, my cross is my wife. Said, you know, Pastor, my cross is there. My wife is my cross. My husband is my cross. That is not the cross there. Right? This means to die daily to self. This is just declaring, like the Lord Jesus Christ in his prayer, says, Heavenly Father, can you let this cup pass over me? But not my will, but yours be done. This is daily dying to self. Taking up the cross is daily dying to self and saying, not my will, Lord, but yours be done. In small things and in big things. You die daily for Christ. When you wake up early in the morning, you sleep at night, until you sleep at night, you say, Lord, not my will be done, but yours be done. In my life, in my family, in my finances, in my talents, Lord, your will be done. You die daily to self. Number four, Mark, last point. A committed follower of Jesus follows Jesus daily. The word there is in the present tense. It means you keep on following Jesus. Amen?
Amen.
You do not follow him this Sunday, disobey him on Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday. It's Saturday, so I have to change my life and obey again. No, it's daily. Keep on following Jesus. Daily following Jesus in your life. And if you will look at these things, oh, what a standard, right? Is it easy to deny yourself, take up your cross, and follow Jesus? It's not easy. Easy or no?
No,
it's not easy. But brothers and sisters in the Lord, if you will look closely in Philippians chapter 2, verse 5 to 8, Jesus exemplified this truth. Jesus exemplified this truth. Jesus denied his rights, took up the cross, and followed the will of the Heavenly Father. I have bad news for you. The things that I mentioned, it's not hard. It's impossible. It's impossible. With your own strength and with my own strength, it is impossible for us to deny ourselves, take up our cross, and follow Jesus daily. That's impossible with our own strength because ourselves says, I want this, mine. It's impossible for us to deny self. That's why we have to go back to the cross of Christ and to surrender our life to Jesus daily. You surrender our lives to the Lord. Have a relationship with Jesus. And the power that raised Jesus from the dead is the same power that will be available for us to live holy lives, to deny ourselves, take up our cross, and follow him. Daily. It is only through the power of the Holy Spirit in you.
Amen.
So if you don't have the Holy Spirit in you, these things are impossible. It's not only hard, it's impossible. But if you have the Holy Spirit, you can do these things through the power of the Holy Spirit that is in you. So, if you look at Philippians chapter 2, verse 19, I want us to look at Philippians chapter 2. Galatians, Ephesians, Philippians chapter 2, verse 13 says, "For it is God who is at work in you," right? "For it is God who is at work in you, both to will and to work for His good pleasure." It is God. It is His power that is available for us. So in conclusion, I want to read Luke chapter 9. Let's go back to Luke chapter 9, verse 24 to 26. "For whoever wishes to save his life will lose it. For whoever loses his life for Jesus' sake, he is the one who will save it. For what is a man profited if he gains the whole world and loses or forfeits himself?" This is a strong reminder, brothers and sisters. "For whoever is ashamed of me and my words, the Son of Man will be ashamed of him when he comes in his glory and the glory of the Father and of the holy angels." What a strong reminder. Jesus loved us first. Jesus gave himself for you and for me. Jesus is great. Amen?
Amen.
Jesus is awesome. Amen?
Amen.
Jesus is worth everything. So with all the love of my heart this morning, and by the grace of God, let us abandon everything for Jesus' sake. Let us deny ourselves. Let us die daily to ourselves. And let us keep on following Jesus. Will you do that? You know, every time we hear the word of God, I'm always giving a chance to the people of God to respond. It's either you're saying, "It's hard, I cannot do it, I will not deny myself, I will not surrender," or you will surrender yourself today. But you know, I'm telling you, it's sure that you will surrender your life. You can surrender your life now, or you can surrender later and it will be too late. Because my Bible says, "Time will come, every knee, every tongue will bow down in the name of Jesus." Brothers and sisters, you have heard the word of God this morning. And I'm praying that you will talk to the Lord today. If you have never surrendered your life to the Lord, this is the time to surrender your life to the Lord. You know me. If you're really committed and following Jesus today, you know me. I'm praying that if you will see that you are not fully committed to the Lord today, I'm begging to surrender your life to the Lord today. Be brought to him today. Let's bow down our heads.
Your soul.
Jesus.